This program is brought to you by the Merdeka Award, an initiative to promote excellence by ExxonMobil, Petronas and Shell.
Hello, this is the Merdeka Award Roundtable. My name is Cynthia Ng. On this show, we bring together thought leaders to discuss issues that are critical to nation building. And sports is a prime example when harnessed its full potential can bring about social change, social inclusion, and it also has the power to bring people together. So that is our topic of discussion today, the future of sports and how it can contribute to nation building. And without further ado, let's bring in our panel for today. I'd like to start with, on my far right, Dr. Wirdati Mohamad Radzi. She is the president of the Malaysian Association for Sport Management, or MASMA. Next to her, we have Dr. Harmi, Taazim, a familiar voice and face on TV. He's a TV sports commentator and also a lecturer at the International Islamic University of Malaysia. And we also have Datuk Ong Kim Swee with us here today, the national coach for Harimau Malaysia. And next to me, we have Yang Amat Mulia Tunku Tan Sri Imran, ibni Almarhum Tunku Jaafar Al-Haj, president of the Olympic Council of Malaysia. And last but not least, we are joined by Marcus Luer, founder and group CEO of Total Sports Asia. Thank you so much for being part of this discussion. Now, before we get into the role of sports in nation building, I'd like to get a sense on the state of sports in Malaysia. Now, with that, I'd like to start with Tunku, because if you look at our past achievements, we have done fairly well, commendable achievement. For example, 2016 was a good year. We had our best showing at the Olympics. Negaraku was sank at the Paralympic Games as well. So, what are your thoughts?
Well, it was a very good year for the Olympic sports, but sport is such a huge subject, and there's so many sports that is played in Malaysia. It's difficult to generalize, and you really can't generalize. Some sports are in their infancy, some sports are very well developed, some sports are, I would say, you know, very much on the way up. Some sports are on the way down. Whether you're talking about their achievement, whether you're talking about their programs, whether you're talking about the growth of the sport, or whether you're talking about sport in schools, you really cannot generalize. I think if you want to generalize, I would say that sport in Malaysia is going okay. It could be much, much better, but also could be much worse.
Okay, let's get the thoughts of other of our speakers, maybe Dr. Wirdati, in terms of achievement and where are we still lacking in terms of sports development in Malaysia?
Well, thank you. I think I have to agree with a lot of what Tunku had mentioned in terms of the inability to generalize about the development of sports. But from an academic point of view, I would go back to the national sports policy, because that would be the governing document for sports development in this country. And whether or not we had achieved would be based on whether or not we had achieved what the national sports policy had set out to do. So I think there are instances where, like Tunku had mentioned, we can see good progress being made, excellent achievement at world-class level, but also areas where I would have to say sorely lacking in terms of organization and management of sports. So my take would be going back to the National Sports Policy 2009 and see whether or not we had fulfilled the objectives of that.
Okay. Now we are here today at the Sepang International Circuit, and that's probably why you might have heard the background noises. That is the sound of a roaring engine. We have a motorsport event going on at the SIC right now. But the SIC is a testament to the milestone that Malaysia has achieved in terms of organizing international world-class sporting event. But the criticism is that we may not have achieved as much in terms of sports achievements. Yes, we have done well. For example, badminton, squash, we have been consistently world-class, but there are still areas that need major improvements, Dr. Harmi?
We have achieved a lot, especially in the Paralympics, and the Olympic boys also done very well last year. In other sports, like in motor racing also, we've done a lot of achievement. We have, for the first time, Malaysian riders winning a race in the World Grand Prix, and the first non-Japanese rider to win a race. We have Afi Sharin is doing well in Moto2, and then we have others as well. But in development, we're talking about in general, because where I'm coming from, as in from media, especially in motor racing, the development is there. In Malaysia, we keep on doing it, and it's been going on. Yes, if you want to have a world class player or a world champion in every sport, I think it's a bit impossible.
Supposed to be more selective in terms of where we place our resources and our assets. Marcus, from your perspective, you have looked at sports across around the region,
right?
And when you look into Malaysia, what do you see?
I think in general, what you just said is exactly what most countries are trying to do. You can't be a champion everywhere. So you pick and choose where somewhat either naturally your athletes have a tendency. So if you look at the African, you know, they have a lot of strong runners, and clearly there's a reason why. Or if you have a lot of people which are very tall, then you're looking for basketball or volleyball. So clearly you should look at sports where you have either a natural, you know, advantage, or there is such a huge passion for it. Let's say take table tennis in China. There are always going to be champions coming out of China tables because it's so large. And similar here, badminton is the sport which clearly is... on a global level, it's probably the only outside of squash, of course. But badminton has a much longer history. But squash really only started with Nicole. Before that, it wasn't really much about squash. But badminton has always been there for much longer. So clearly, Malaysia should continue there and put the resources in there. Similar then, but you look at sports like football, which is, I think we all would say, it's the number one sport in the country. But on an international level, and I don't want to step on the coach's toes here, we all know we're nowhere near of where we should be. So how do we deal with that? That there is so much passion for the sport. There's clearly, you know, a lot of resource and money being poured in it, but we're nowhere near where we need to be. So it's a struggle.
When we mentioned about sports, a lot of comparisons are being made to the glory days of the 1970s when we qualified for world levels. And what's your take on the development of football in Malaysia? I'm sure you get a lot of comments and criticism, but it's such a loved sport, a lot of passion among the people.
Well, for me, most important, we have to look forward. If you're talking about 1970s, due respect to the team, during that period, I don't think all Asia countries are playing football. And it's good that we qualified, we have the history. But at the moment, I believe that we need to go back to the grassroots, where football doesn't achieve success in a short period. We need a longer time. So with proper grassroots program that needs a lot of collaboration, because in football, you can't only have FAM or you can't only have the states, but you must have Ministry of Education, Ministry of Sports, Football Association of Malaysia, and even the state's government to come and make it happen. If we don't start with our grassroots program, it will end up the same thing every year in and out. So I believe that even though we don't have success now, but we have to start planning. Everyone has to start working together. It's good to have roundtable talk as what we're having now, with all the departments that involve in football development.
A few years ago, when our Prime Minister, Datuk Sri Najib, was a Minister of Youth and Sport, he asked me, if there's one thing you would do in sport, what would you do? And I said, you mean I only have one thing? I said, because, you know, in sport, there's so many things to do. He said, one thing. I said, okay, I would put sport under the Ministry of Education, and half your battle is won. And I still believe that. And I think it is something that government should look at. That should be the way forward, because it really is half the battle. Some of our best sports facilities are in schools. Secondly, That's where, as the Datuk Ng just mentioned, that's where it has to start at the junior level. Sports, if you're going to be achieving world champions, you know, it has to be, you know, start at the junior level, because it becomes a culture for them, it becomes something that is inbred in them. So you have to start it at school. Today, I think there's a definite lack of expertise in schools vis-a-vis sport. You know, they don't actually train teachers to be sports teachers or coaches. But once a ministry is tasked with having an objective, and if sports is one of the objectives, and if the KPI was you not only have got to produce, you know, A1 students, you've also got to produce A1 sports people, athletes. As I said, that's part of the battle. Then they have to think about ways and means, how to utilize their facilities, how to utilize their resources. And the one thing that is very glaring, I think all of us know, we drive around Kuala Lumpur or anywhere in the country, and we look at the school fields on a Saturday and a Sunday, they are empty. Beautiful fields, empty. You look at any other country, they would be packed with people playing some sort of sport, and a lot of it will be football.
Okay. Now we'll get to more on that, and as well, I want to touch on grassroots development, as mentioned by Datuk on earlier, but we have to take this discussion to our commercial break. But do stay with us, we'll be back shortly. You're tuning in to the Merdeka Award Roundtable, and we're talking about sports and how it can contribute to nation building. Now, sports in itself, we talk about athlete and grassroots development, is by its very nature at the very heart of what sport is. And my question to my panel is, do we have an efficient athlete grassroots development program? Let's start with Datuk.
Well, I don't think we have really a good structure at the moment, yeah. And there's only one team in Malaysia that I can see is doing good development program, that is in Johor, where JDT has started a very good structure or concept, where not only in terms of developing players, but the facilities that they have. So I hope that the other states or other clubs that can really upgrade whatever facilities or development program that they have, like what JDT has been doing. Just imagine if JDT can produce about 50 players of under 14 players, and all the states that we have, 50 players in every category. So we have bigger pool of players. We have to understand, in football, not everybody can make it to the international era arena. So they have to start thinking, how can we make it not only with bigger pool of players, but we want quality players, as what Tuanku was saying. We need good coaches. We need good trainers, where not only teachers, where it's very important in young age, you need to have the right basic, like football, techniques that they must master before they grow to when they come to 16, 17 or 18 years old.
The example of JDT, also if we talk about Bukit Jalil Sports School and Bandar Penawa, these are schools and JDT producing talents at the teen level, more on the teen level. But what about before that, where the crucial age of, you know, identifying talent when they are very young, perhaps kindergarten, for example? Dr. Reda, do you have an opinion on this?
Okay. I think the sports schools that we have in Malaysia currently, we have 20. Four of them at the federal level and the rest are at state levels. I think it's quite difficult to see the achievement based on the products of these sports schools as it is now. I mean, before that, before we have sports schools, we do have good success stories from our own athletes. But now that we do, not so much improvement in terms of the output. So there could be something that we need to look into, and as a researcher, that is always something that I would like to look into. But I know for a fact that in sports schools, the curriculum are still based with the kind of curriculum that the Ministry of Education have. For example, the period of learning is from morning until afternoon. But the students will have to go for training early, very early in the morning. And when they come to class, they are either very tired or couldn't focus. So there should be something like a re-look into how the curriculum or the program delivery is being made, so that we can hear more success stories from the products of the sports schools.
Yeah, Tunku. I'd like to just say that I think that the sports schools actually start to, at too young an age. And I think what has happened, I think, with the creation of these sports schools, a lot of the normal schools who used to excel in sport have almost given up those sports. So rather than adding on to what we had already, I think it's just replaced what we had. And I think that, as I agree with you, they have to rethink. I think that sometimes specialization, centralization, is not necessarily a good idea, and certainly not at too young an age.
Let me just maybe add something. We did a program a few years back now in India with one of the largest news channels in the country, and a sponsor was brought in, and it was all driven towards, the product was called Marks for Sports, which basically meant in India at that time, which I think is similar to here, you didn't really get credit for it when you did sports in school. So you do it as an extracurriculum, but you don't really get marks for it. So India had the same problem. And if you look at Indian records in the Olympics, not really bright. So they looked at it in the same way, that once children become, you know, get credit and you get rewarded in a sense, there are two things. The parents will start focusing on it, because it's not just about, you know, getting an A in math or in English, but it's about, you know, becoming an overall, you know, strong character. So that was a very, very successful campaign. The government started to look at it very seriously on the back of basically newspapers and everyone else starting to talk about this campaign. So I think that's where it sometimes has to start. You kind of have to start looking at it in a different way. And you have to incentivize people. So if there's no incentive for you to do well in sports, outside if you one of these, you know, 0.1% who might become a professional, like we were talking about earlier, sports isn't just about the pros. That's the pinnacle of it. When we all look towards that, that's great. But in reality, if you're trying to create a sporting culture, that means all of us. That's every single child and every single person in the country. So, and you know, majority of them will never become superstars or even good athletes, but they can you know, get something in their early life and which carries through their whole life in that sense. So I think that's really what Marks for Sports was all about. It wasn't about just, you know, identifying the next superstar, but it was identifying a sporting culture.
I think what Marcus mentioned is so important. You know, you're not talking, we should not be talking, when we talk about junior development, about whether they're going to be world champion or whether they're getting to the national team. What we should be talking about, whether they're enjoying the sport, it's healthy for them, you've got the right moral values, ethics, you know, they become, you know, good citizens, good leaders, good team players. Those are what we're looking for first, I think, you know, when we're creating this organized activity for sport. Not the top ones will then come through, they'll even ask their parents, I think this is too simple for me, I want to be more you know, more football oriented or more squash oriented.
Before I go to the next break, let me get your thoughts, Datuk, about what the gentleman has just mentioned about. First of all, we need to foster that competitive sports culture in Malaysia before we want to talk about creating world champions.
Well, I'd like to come back to what Doctor was saying regarding sports schools. Yeah, I faced a situation when I was coaching Bukit Jalil sports schools, seven, 8 years ago, the students asking me, I mean football players asking me, we call it sports schools. The Ministry of Education wants us to excel in study. Ministry of Sports wants us to be good in sport. So where do we want to go? Yeah. So I face a problem when I have to take example Nazmi Faiz Manso. He has to go to Indonesia for SEA Games and have to skip his SPM, and they make it a big issue. Sorry to say, I'm not saying that study or, you know, it's not important. It's important. But at the same time, look at Azmi now. You know, like, football career is very short. Yeah, and what is he getting now? I think that is something that is very difficult if you were to concentrate on your study. Like I said, he has talent. If you have talents, why must you look upon something else? If you have talents in football, tennis, or whatever sports, you have to concentrate on your sports. If, like what doctor was saying, if we can help you in other way to excel, like journalist, or probably you can become a referee. Well, there's something that involves with football. So where do we want to go as sports school?
The idea that you go into sports just because you cannot do it academically, I think it's a fallacy. 90% of collegiate sponsorship at universities in the US are for athletes. So that is something to think about. We don't have that kind of support. And again, back to the selection of the kind of careers that the student athletes could go into. So this should be, you know, inbuilt in the program so that they will know exactly where they're going with the sports that they're choosing and also the kind of education that they're getting.
And that's what we want to talk about next, sports as an industry. We'll go for a short commercial break. We'll be back shortly. Stay with us. $700 billion, that's how much the global sports industry generates, and it supports millions of jobs. Yet in Malaysia, it's not seen as a viable career choice for many of us. Why is that? Let's start with Dr. Harmi.
Well, like I said just now, sports is not just to be in there as a player. There's a lot of other industry to support sports. It's part of a growing industry in the world and in Malaysia. So, like we've been discussed, only 1% out of 100, we can only find one in the whole Jamaica. Only one Usain Bolt. So, what about the rest? So there's a lot of other industry supporting sports, as Datuk Ong Kim Swee was saying that can be part of football. Not necessarily being a player. Sometimes you need to know that there's a lot of other things in sport, and that's to educate people, to educate them.
Is there a lack of awareness on the supporting industries?
Yes, that is the culture, like I said, a culture. Culture is not just a culture, go and play football every evening or play tennis, but the culture is the whole setup, the whole surrounding, the parents, the kids, and people must understand. Sport, it's not just what you see on the field. It's what around there. It's a lot more. You could have 11 players in a team, but the whole squad consists of 30, 40, including the physio, including the coaches and everything. So you can be part of that as well in sports.
However, Dr. Radzi, your thoughts about, there are a lot of career opportunities, but the path is not as well defined in Malaysia.
Well, when we talk about industry, sports industry, we are talking about the professionalization of sports itself. And based on the literatures, there are three phases. The first one is the solidifying of foundations, knowledge, theoretical foundations. The second one is the creation of subculture. And the third one is the acceptance from the community. In Malaysia right now, I would say that we are going to the second stage where we have the theoretical foundations, we have the sports schools, we also have the universities. I think more than 10 universities are offering sports management courses, sports related, sports sciences courses. And that generates a lot of demands from the students going into sports schools, sports universities as well, courses in the universities. But we are still lacking in the second stage where we talk about the creation of subculture. Professional careers like lawyers or doctors, they have professional guilds that took care of the people in the industry. We don't have that as yet. So by definition, professional in Malaysia will have to be based on acts. But there are other definitions of professionals. We already have the professional football leagues, for example, in terms of the kind of financial interest that this industry generates. A research in 2013 saw that the estimation of the value of Malaysian sports industry is around 37 billion ringgit. So there is money in this business. But again, when we talk about the career paths, it is the creation of the subculture. It is not yet complete. And before we go to the final stage, which is the community sanction, where people will accept, if you wanted somebody to manage sports, you'll have to get somebody who graduated from a sports management course. That is still in the works, I would say.
Well, I think the sport as an industry, I mean, I would define it even wider than how you've defined it. I think that sport transcends all walks of life and everything. And until take one sport, until you've grown that sport from the point of view of the participants, the athletes, and the juniors and the players, and the spectators and the interest. It's very difficult for, and then this probably goes on to Marcus in a minute, for people to get involved in that sport. You know, you got to have that, create that mass behind a particular sport before people start putting money into it. If not, they're not going to get a return. And so, you know, I still believe that, you know, it doesn't happen overnight, or it can be two-pronged. Really, you know, you can start from the top with the sponsors coming in, you know, to sponsor big leagues, big competitions. But it also means that there's got to be a lot of grasswork being done at the bottom to really, you know, ensure that the base grows and that, you know, there's interest in that whole activity.
Marcus would probably say that it's good business to invest in sports, but not many think so. So,
well, I mean, I think absolutely, it is a good business, and there is money to be made. And if you look at it, all of us are in the industry, right? None of us is an athlete sitting here. We're all, you know, obviously engaged and make a living with it. I think there's a couple of examples come to my mind. One is Singapore. I remember in the year 2000, they set up a fund, which was at that time about $500 million was put aside for a 10-year period. To drive three elements. One was exactly the whole grassroots concept of they want the Singaporeans out there, go out, run, jog, do something, you know, on the weekend. Second was marquee events, bring, you know, major sort of sporting events to the country to, again, build up that whole following of the on a professional level. And third was build the industry, bring in agencies, bring in federations, create this. So typical Singapore style, when they put this together, they'll do it. And if you compare, you go to Singapore now on a weekend, literally there's in every corner of the country, you would have activities, you would have runs, you have bike races, you have swimming competition, triathlons, etc. So it's a much smaller country, therefore, yes, it is easier to do and control it in a way. China is now doing exactly the same thing as well. They're going through the massive, I'm sure read about it, not just in football, of course, that maybe is a bit over the top, but there's a general huge push to build a sports industry and to build that sports culture. So it can be done, you know, it needs, and you really need to separate out the grassroots to the professional parts and all this stuff. They're not too, they worked in hand, of course, but they really need it. They need their own attention. And I think the minute Malaysia does that, and there's no reason why you couldn't do it here as well, there is a passion for sports already. I mean, you just watch what happens during the Suzuki Cup or, you know, during Thomas Cup, these things. You see the country, there is a sporting culture. Maybe as a slightly of a couch potato sporting culture and not just being there physically playing it, but there is a starting point, and that's good, right?
Speaking of couch potato, I'm sure, Doctor, you have comments on, a lot of people comment about a football performance, and you know, going back to what Marcus has said, do we have that kind of supporting elements to help develop football?
Yeah, we do. I mean, definitely FAM, we have a lot of, in terms of sponsorship, yeah, the boys has been exposed, especially when we have the era of Harimau Muda. Harimau Muda is where we develop and we expose players abroad, like 19 years old, 20, 21 years old. The reason why we have success in 2009 SEA Games in Laos, where we won gold. Following year, we have a Suzuki Cup champion under Datuk K. Rajagopal, and follow up with 2011 SEA Games. I believe if you look back at the program that we have, the Harimau Muda players or program makes the difference. Where these boys are exposed to Slovakia League, where we were there for 6 months, 3 months, and we play in a lot of international games. And there's one stage when I was in Slovakia for 6 months with these boys, Datuk Rajagopal called up 11 players from my team to play with the national team. Preparation for the 2010 Suzuki Cup. And from there, the players got exposed with Battle League. And that is where I achieved success in 2011. Because, sorry to say, it's not that we are looking down at our league. But at the same time, we must know where our standard is. Example, like when we play in National Premier League in Queensland, Australia. There's a lot of talks, there's a lot of critics saying that why are we playing in amateur league? But that is how they run football in Australia. But at the end of the day, where is Australia football? They are up there. But we are still there. Because of amateur league, you are saying that we are playing in amateur league because of the words amateur. But they are much more professional than us. And there's one stage where Australia club, Wellington, I don't know which club is that, play in a world club football, where during that time their players is they are part-timers and they still play in very high level football. So what do we want here? The sponsorship will come if we do well. And you look at football, the rights of the rights that we got for our M League. So there's a lot of sponsorship, not only for TV rights, but from other ways of sponsorship.
Each sport is in charge of its own destiny. And you know, whether companies put money in that sport really will depend on that sport. You know, and how those that are running those sports really ensure that that sport becomes popular, becomes interesting, becomes entertaining, and becomes, you know, have a lot of people coming through and grows. You know, sponsors are not interested in putting money, I'm sure Marcus will tell us, that into something that is going to be static. You know, they want, you know, it to grow. And the sport must be seen and actually be growing and popular.
What is Malaysian doing well? And perhaps we should focus on those core spots where we have the potential and maybe let go some of the rest. We'll discuss that after this short break.
We'll be right back.
is the Merdeka Award Roundtable, and earlier before the break, we're talking about sports that we Malaysians do well, perhaps with the limited resources that we have, allocation for funding for sports. Perhaps it's time for us to take a look at what we really truly do well, focus on those core sports, and let go maybe some that we do not do too well.
I can't say I can't choose those sports because if not, I'll be killed by my membership okay. of the Olympic Council of Malaysia, where we have over 45 sports. But certainly, there are some sports where we know that Malaysia can really do well, can really get those gold medals that we're really looking for, and that's all to do with the science, the physiology. You know, it's obvious that the games of skill, you know, we are very good at. You know, your badmintons, your archery, hockey, are all football, are all games of skill. Games where you need a huge height, you know, maybe, you know, we're not ever going to beat the All Blacks, for instance, at rugby or the, you know, some of these huge basketballers.
Let's talk from the commercial viability perspective, sports in Malaysia, where are the opportunities?
I think we said it earlier already, football is by far the number one sport, and therefore the opportunities in football are probably the largest. It's funny, when you talk to people in an office, there's a lot of talk about the Premier League and the international football, but I know, because I've seen the statistics, the ratings for local football is much bigger in most cases than the ratings for international football. You know, if you ask the average person, would probably wouldn't believe you that a Premier League match gets a lower rating than a match where Selangor plays Pahang, for example. So I think that's where there is still a lack of education within the within sponsorship in other areas, that local football actually is big. It is a true mass sport. There are 30, 40,000 people in the stadiums across the country on every weekend. So to me, the football sport as an industry, the league as an industry, has, you know, still a long way to go, and there is massive opportunities for brands and you know, people in, to work in it, as well as, of course, for athletes to continue to grow. You know, the Malaysian Football League isn't the pinnacle of football, naturally, but it is a great stepping stone to the next level above it. So there is a lot of things, you know, which you can do in football. Batman is the other no-brainer. Squash, I think, globally is a very niche sport, so it's hard to really say, you know, how much you want to continue that, and is there a legacy beyond Nicole, I guess, right?
How to do that? That's the problem, is that giving money, yes, but the whole structure of it, the finding talent, the development, the culture, to educate people. I remember the time that when our Formula One came to Malaysia, was in back in 1999. The first job at that time by the station that I worked for, to educate people on the sports, that people understand. If not, you were watching the race, the car go round and round every weekend. Nobody going to be interested, and there's no Malaysian drivers in there as well. But to understand the sport first, the money must be in the sports, and to not only for the sport itself, but it's across the board of understanding the sports, yeah?
Dr. Beda, how do you see sports as a potential generating revenue? Because in some countries, sports is seen as a financial liability. You know, we keep increasing public funds into development of sports, but are we getting that kind of results that we want?
Well, I think to answer that, I will pick up from the responses that I had heard from the panels today, and it will go back to football again. It is an undisputed fact that sports can actually bring money. A research done by the Ministry of Youth and Sports, the Stirling report done by a university in Scotland looking at the kind of income that sports can bring is staggering. It ranges from 9 billion ringgit Malaysia to 35 billion. So it's in the billions. And that is where potential for new revenue generation sector that Malaysia is looking for would probably lie. So I think there is a huge potential in that. And I think to select the kind of sports that we wanted to promote would be counterproductive in terms of we need icons for this country. We need people that inspire us to keep us moving. I mean, beyond Nicole, we need to find another icon, or maybe icons in another sport. This is what drives the Malaysian spirit forward. So I think in terms of investing in sports, if it comes from the government, yes, we are quite aware of the condition of the world economy at this stage. But sport is something that you might have to invest even though you are losing. For example, I'm involved with the a study done by the National Sports Council to see, a study on behalf of Malaysia, to see whether or not ASEAN would be able to host the 2034 FIFA World Cup. And the overarching idea was, we are not going to be able to do it as a region because of the financial implications. But think about the kind of you know, interest, or the kind of ideas and publicity that the region could generate. And definitely there will be only three countries that will be, you know, highlighted in that. It will be Malaysia, Thailand, and also Indonesia. So these are the kind of considerations that policymakers would have to consider. They would lose out money, but how will that affect the social aspect of sport? Would be, you know,
it's an investment. Actually, I wouldn't say losing money. Yeah, I would say it's truly an investment in the future. You know, whether it's the SEA Games, which we'll talk about later, or other those large sporting events, they really change the perception of sports for the uneducated. Let's put it this way, right? Someone who's really just, you know, watching it by chance. They get inspired because this is the first time they've had a chance to see this live, maybe, or be in the stadium. And bringing the World Cup here, again, would clearly make it, it's a financial burden in a sense, but I think the investment in the future of the sport and in general, it'd be huge.
On its own, you know, just a money return on the investment. Yeah. It's not that way. I think you have to look at it holistically. Even everyone says that Formula One, what a lot of money to spend, etc., etc., etc. But look at it from the tourism point of view. Look at it from the, you know, how many times Kuala Lumpur is mentioned, even though the KL Grand Prix, a Malaysian, you know, it has happened months before. You know, they're still talking about an incident, you know, and that happened here many, many, you know, months ago. So I think it's you know, it's difficult to quantify the, you know, investment, and therefore it is also difficult to say what one should be looking into. I mean, I must defend squash, because I was the first secretary of squash, and I started the squash association. But yes, I think Marcus is right. It's not a mainstream sport, but it nevertheless it is a sport that has its importance in the sense that it's in the Commonwealth Games. It's in the Asian Games. We're still one of the top nations. You can't just let it go, and there's not a lot of money you need to put into squash. You know, squash and football is like, you know, chalk and cheese. I mean, you need to just support a little bit of squash, whereas, you know, in football you have to have multi-pronged support because no one party can do it.
Because football needs not only the president or the owner. It needs to work from the owner right to the groundsman. So everybody is playing a very important role. You know, even if the groundsman doesn't look after the field well, it's going to jeopardize the performance. So everybody play a part in it. So it's a huge, huge things that you have to think about. Like what Tuanku said, probably squash, you less headache. Yeah? With the terms of in a way of management, arranging things. But in football, there's a lot of aspect that you have to look at.
All right. Now we have to go for our last commercial break, but when we come back, let's talk about the SEA Games. This is an exciting event happening here in Malaysia, and what are the opportunities and what are our aspirations after the break?
This is the Merdeka Award Roundtable. We're talking about sports, and sports on its own has this tremendous power to bring people together despite their differences, and it creates unity, it helps to promote our pride. Have you able to utilize sports to our best advantage in this respect when it comes to nation building for Malaysia, Doctor?
Sports has the ability to transcend a lot of barriers, and I think there's a lot of potential for sports to be used as a nation building agenda. It is already outlined in the national sports policy that it is an instrument that the government is using to develop the country. My only concern would be, how do we evaluate the success that we had made, the progress that we had made through the achievement of the national sports policy? It has always been my greatest concern, because if you look at the policy words, it is perfect. They outline every single thing that is needed by this country to achieve sporting excellence at all levels. And I'm wondering why we're not achieving it. There's a research paper in the European Association for Sports Management that was questioning why Malaysia has not been able to win a gold medal at the Olympics. And that disturbed me, because I know for a fact that we as a country worked very hard for that. And I also know for a fact that we also need to relook at the strategies of managing sports in this country, like what we had mentioned, all of us here had mentioned previously. So I think that would be my aspirations, if you will. For
to me, it's all about a healthy society, a society which through sport can integrate itself, come together, be harmonious, and learn the right values. I mean, sport does teach young people the right values of rule of law, of respect, etc. And that is probably the fundamental thing for me and sport. You know, in the Olympics, we saw everyone, the whole of the country, irrespective of ethnic religion, supporting Lee Chong Wei, supporting Azizol on the track, on the cycling track. So, and we all support Nicole David, who's from another ethnic background. So it doesn't. I think it doesn't matter who the icon is, as Doctor was saying. It is the fact that they are in the end Malaysians, and I think that is the importance of sport. And SEA Games will prove it.
I think, let me jump on the SEA Games. I think the SEA Games is one of the largest, one of the biggest opportunities that the country will see for years and years to come to do some true nation building. I think the effect, and I'm sure you've seen studies what happens when the Olympics are coming or major sporting events to a country, the World Cup, etc. It fascinates the youth. They have an opportunity to be at the stadium. They're really engaging with it on a different level, maybe as a volunteer or in other many ways. So I do believe the legacy of the SEA Games, which are coming here this year, we'll see for the next 10 years in the country. You will see the 5-year-olds, the 10-year-olds now saying, I want to be there too one day with that medal. I want to hear the national anthem being played. And that's the beauty of the SEA Games. Every country in Southeast Asia has an opportunity to win. At the Olympic level, at the Asian Games level, we all know Southeast Asia doesn't do so well in many, or in several sports at least. But the SEA Games are something for everyone. And so that's why I love the event. It really creates such a great atmosphere. We've seen it in Singapore a couple of years ago, and I've no doubt Malaysia will do this here as well. And again, we'll set, hopefully really truly take the enthusiasm which will be there for those 2 weeks, there is no doubt, or even for 3 weeks, which when you add the ASEAN Para Games to it as well, of course, let's not forget those athletes. There is 3 to 4 weeks where the country will stand still. But what do we do after? That's the real trick.
I think yes, sports is a tool for unity. We always we are Malaysian, is one and foremost that no matter who represent the country, as long as you're Malaysian, then we will support. Like Tunku said, and I remember that I was so frustrated when Datuk Lee Chong Wei lost in the final. But so the whole thing stopped to watch, you know, and the whole country, the whole country stopped during 92 when we won the Thomas Cup, and the whole country stopped watching football team won Suzuki Cup. Or I went back in 1989 when we won the gold medal in SEA Games in Stadium Merdeka Stadium, because I was there watching Datuk's colleague winning the gold medal, and I still get a goosebump here. And as a reporter, it is something that when I went to SEA Games or any other games, and when I heard Negaraku being played, and I'm not an athlete, I'm just a supporting role there, but I can feel the pride and the goosebump, and you know, being Malaysian. So that is important. What SEA Games is all about, unity and everyone working together to achieve one goal. Yeah.
SEA Games. What are your aspirations?
Well, I have very good experience in SEA Games. I've been through 3 SEA Games, from 2011, 13 and 15, the last one in Singapore, where it's a very good outing, especially in 2011, where we won the gold medal against our rival, that is Indonesia, in front of 100 over 1,000 spectators. Yeah, and during that time, social media was not that powerful yet, I can say. And we doesn't know what is going what happened in our home back yet. But the information that we received after the game, you know, everybody is at this mama stall. Everyone, doesn't matter who you are, they are behind you, cheering you. So that's something that that I believe will unite everybody. Even when we come back from Indonesia, after the game, we arrive about 5 o'clock in the morning. I think the spectators that watch at Mama stall are there at the airport greeting us. So this kind of environment, atmosphere, I believe will help us not only being like what Tuanku was saying, that moral ethic, but at the same time will educate all of us as a Malaysian that sports can unite everybody.
And it's no coincidence that we are hosting the games from the 19th to the 31st of August. Yes. The closing ceremony is on the 31st of August, Hari Merdeka, and that is very significant. The other interesting thing that we will be doing in this year's SEA Games is putting the marathon as the first event, and with the marathon will be a fun run for the people. So anyone can really join in with the marathon runners. They will not get obviously right involved, but I mean they'll be there on the same course, everything, probably a shorter run, but it'll be the great start to the games, and I commend that to the youngsters. Enter that fun run because you'll get a special shirt or whatever.
Right, that sounds
and that's
exciting.
Where the sponsors will come in.
All right.
These are creative new ideas. We've seen that in other events as well, that you're setting up a marathon course or a triathlon course just for the athletes. It's a big wasted opportunity. You know, bring people in there. They can't run together exactly at the same moment, obviously. But you start them off a little later, and all of a sudden, you know, you're combining the power of the games, where you have top athletes performing, with the mass participation. That's the real trick, and that creates magic.
And Mark has just talked briefly about legacy. Another thing that I learned from Rio is, you know, that most of the sports that were there in Rio created that opportunity to introduce their sport to the people. So they had, although they had their big event, they also had a side event where children could come and try out their hand out, and they had people say, now, the first 2 days of the games, archery is going to be on the Merdeka Square, the Padang, and I think that's a fabulous opportunity for archery then to continue to open the thing for young kids to learn about archery, because who knows about archery? I mean, you know, today I'm not sure I would know where I would learn to do archery. You know, so this will be a great opportunity, and every sport can do that.
And of course, ultimately to create that interest and love for sport and creating that critical mass sporting culture in Malaysia. Thank you so much to my panel for being part of this discussion. It was a great pleasure speaking to you and valuable insights on the development of sports in the country. And thank you to our viewers as well for watching. And of course, thank you to the Sepang International Circuit for hosting the 16th Merdeka Award Roundtable. And do want to continue the discussion. We are on social media, on Facebook. So do send in your thoughts and feedback. Once again, my name is Cynthia Ng, and we'll see you next time.
This program was brought to you by the Merdeka Award, an initiative to promote excellence by ExxonMobil, Petronas, and Shell.